Good morning. Welcome back to the Retirement Report. I'm Hank Parrott, your host. All right, we're gonna, before we dive back in, I'm gonna grab the phone. This is Timmy. Whoops, wrong one. Here we go. Timmy, welcome to the Retirement Report.
Hello.
Hi there. How are you doing this morning?
Oh, pretty good.
Good. How can I help this morning?
Well, I was gonna ask. I got one mortgage payment left, and I'm 49. Mm-hmm. I have a Roth IRA. It's a small one. I think I put in like 80. I just started here about, I guess, about 3 or 4 years, and don't have a lot of debt since we don't have the mortgage payment. And want to try to get. Want to set up something. What's a good plan to set up for retirement?
Are you putting, do you have money, do you have access to a 401k through work?
No, I'm self-employed. I have a lawn care business.
Okay, have you set up a SEP IRA?
No, I don't think I set up one of those yet.
Okay, this would be probably one of the best ones. A SEP IRA allows you to put more money in. Again, a regular IRA, you're looking at only $6,500 that you can contribute, where a SEP IRA, again, you can put in, you know, depending on your income, but you could put in, again, $24,000 potentially a year. So you can put a lot more money into a SEP than a regular IRA. So I would recommend setting up a SEP, basically a
and
SEP
IRA.
And
do I do that through, who I got mine through is Northwestern Mutual.
Right.
So I set it up through them.
With Northwestern, what kind of account do you have with them now?
That's the IRA account I have.
It's an IRA. Is it in mutual funds, that kind of thing?
Yes.
Yeah, it'd be the same kind of thing. So with a SEP IRA, yes, you can do that as well. You want to make sure, by the way, when it comes to investing, I talk about how the smart money invests. And one of the ways that we look at is understanding how to invest in these different things. So, and I'm not sure with Northwestern or with, you know, typical broker-dealers, you're usually looking at what are called actively managed funds. If you can find a way to do that through index investing, you're going to come out a lot better and with lower costs. So one of the things I would look at in investing, it's not just how much money you're saving, which of course is important, but it's also how you're investing, making sure you have the proper asset allocation, diversification, and understanding the difference between active management and what we'll call index investing. And the difference is significant over time. You want to reduce your costs. You want to make sure that you've got the proper asset allocation models with indexing. Even of course, it's still very, very important that that's done right. But if it's done correctly, you'll do much better there than you will with an actively managed mutual funds. And you'll also, you know, so that means you'll get better returns. You'll get less volatility, a lower standard deviation on your portfolios. And of course, you know, one of the big things is you'll minimize cost as well. And the more you minimize costs, it's more money you get to keep.
Yeah.
All right.
So you, when I set up an appointment with Northwestern Mutual, I asked them about a SEP IRA.
Sure. When you talk to them, about a SEP IRA where you can put more money aside. And who does your taxes for you?
I have Osterfeld. Because of my CPA.
Okay, whoever does your taxes, you want to talk to them about how much of your income can be put away into a SEP. They can do the calculation for you to let you know the dollar amount that you can put in.
Oh, okay.
All right?
Uh-huh.
All right, good luck. Thanks.
Thank you. Uh-huh.
You know, one of the things when it comes to investing, and I've talked about it again, is that understanding how to invest is so critical. I see clients come in all the time, new clients coming in, and one of the things when we do an investment analysis, we see a lot of actively managed funds. There's a lot of buying and selling. You have transaction costs. You have higher expense ratios. You may have loaded funds where you have sales loads up front. So they're very expensive, typically, in terms of how you invest. And the results, because they're trying to beat the market and they're doing it through a lot of trading, it's not just that they're having to overcome a lot of high costs, but they also, it just doesn't work. All right, we see there's Dalbar, which is an independent research group, shows us in fact what works. All right, they show that the average investor gets like about 1/3 to 1/2 of the return of the market because of things like trying to time the market or stock picking, or you know, active management basically utilizes those same strategies. And again, we see with the research that it just doesn't work, that the indices, the index investing will beat that every time. And then if you can even beat that, all right, so if you look at Vanguard as an example, and they have a number of index funds and target funds, but if you look at the way they put those together, all right, versus the asset allocation models that we have with the academic research available to us today, you can see, again, a big difference. You could be talking about, you know, 1.5-2% a year difference in return, and that's quite significant over time. It's a huge difference, in fact, when you compound and everything. So understanding how these things work is so critical. Now, if you'd like to find out more about your own investment plan, if you'd like to learn more about investing, be one of the first 10 callers to my office this morning, 615-376-5325. Tess is standing by. She'll take your information. We'll take a look at how you're currently investing. And based on how you're investing, I can show you your financial future in terms of how that's going to do, what the average rate of return over the last 10 years. We'll do Morningstar reports on your investments. I'll be able to dig down with you then and show you those mutual funds that you own, what's in them. You know, what kind of stock holdings, how many stocks are in them? Are they index funds or are they actively managed funds? We'll look at your bond funds. Do you have junk bonds in those bond mutual funds? You may not know. If you've got a high yield bond fund, you most likely do, but there, you even find it in other bond funds as well. Long duration bonds. This adds a lot of interest rate risk. And the Federal Reserve just said they're going to be, excuse me, not Federal Reserve, the Federal Reserve has said they're going to raise interest rates 3 times in this next year. That's their plan, is to continue increasing the interest rate. So when you see interest rates going up, that's going to put downward pressure on your bond funds, meaning they're going to lose money, especially if they have long duration bonds in them. Long-term bonds are very interest rate sensitive. Do you know what you have in your portfolio currently? If you'd like to know, be one of the first 10 callers, 615-376-5325. Tess is standing by to get your information. She'll send you out a little packet, a checklist of things to bring in with to your appointment with me. And when you come in to see me, I'll also give you a free copy of my book, 7 Steps to Financial Freedom and Retirement. Chapter 4, in fact, is How the Smart Money Invests. All right? We want to take a look at that. Let me see. Did I do that right? Nope. Actually, Chapter 5. Chapter 5 is How the Smart Money Invests, and it gets into a lot of things I talk about here on the show at different times, and it's a great help for you, I tell you. It gets into the academic research and all the different things that, you know, Dalbar and other studies that show what really work when it comes to investing. There is a science to investing. Understanding it and applying it to your portfolios can make a huge difference for you over your lifetime. It could be the difference, in fact, with running out of money and not running out of money, making sure you'll never run out of money, in fact, if invested properly. All right, benefits adjusted. We're going to go back to our approaching retirement. We were talking about Social Security a little bit. So benefits adjust based on when you take them. As I said, if you take it 62, you're going to get 25% less. It's interesting to find, by the way, so the more you put it off, so you could, if you get 25% less at 62 and you get 32% more if you wait to 70 from 66, huge difference, right? You'll be talking about, you know, 50-60% difference in terms of how much more money you'll get by waiting. And again, your own situation, though. I've got clients that have come in, they've got health issues and the like, and they're saying, you know, I don't think I'll make it past the age 80 if even that. And so their planning may be different than someone that comes in and their parents have both lived to be in their late 80s or 90s or still around and in their 90s. Their planning is going to look different, right? So 43% plan to take benefits between age 64 and 69, and then only 6% though plan to take benefits at age 70 or later. I am seeing more and more people that plan that, though, that are saying I'm going to wait till 70 because they want to get the biggest benefit they can. Understanding another part, so that's the Social Security piece. So when we get to age 66 or 67, depending on, you know, well, 62 is the earliest at which you can take Social Security, taking a look at your situation, getting an analysis done where you can see what would work best for you, how that best, you know, looks best. When I do a planning of someone and show them their financial future, we look at, well, if I take 62, if I take, you know, it could be 64, 65, 66, 70. You know, we look at all these different scenarios. We'll do what ifs. Well, what if I did this? I've got a lady in recently, for instance, she's saying, well, I may work to age 70, but then again, what if I wanted to retire, you know, next year at 65? Can I do that? Well, we'll run the numbers and see what that would look like. Would you run out of money or would you be okay? And what do you need to make on your money to make sure you'd be okay, and what's the safest way to do that? These are all the kinds of questions we answer when we do planning. All right, now the next piece is comes Medicare. At age 65, you're eligible for Medicare. If you're still working and you have a company plan, a company health benefits, you can delay taking Social Security without, or excuse me, Medicare without benefit, without any penalty as far as your Part B. We're going to get into Part A, Part B, and Part D when it comes to Medicare benefits. So understanding how that works, Medicare Part A, we'll go to the next slide for that one. Medicare Part A is your hospitalization insurance. Okay, so everybody gets that. There's no charge for it, no premium cost. It does, however, have deductibles and co-insurance. Now at 65, everybody needs to sign up for that one. Part B, which is your outpatient care, if you already have a health plan, if you're still working, you can delay signing up for Part B, which is about $134 a month, by the way, but why pay that premium if you've already got coverage? You can delay and not have a penalty because you're still covered. Now, once your coverage ends, your health benefits, you retire, as an example, and those health benefits go away, you immediately need to sign up for Part B and start that premium. We'll go to the next slide then when we come back. So Medicare Part B, that outpatient care, this is the one that you do, again, not only do you have that premium of $134 a month, but you also have deductibles and coinsurance with that. And then Medicare Part D, if you want prescription coverage, that's through private carriers, typically in that $30-$35 range per month. And there's a whole lot of deductibles, coinsurance, donut hole. It's a, you know, there's a understanding, again, it doesn't cover everything. And how are you going to plug in the gaps? Well, we're going to talk about that when we come back. All right, first we're going to take a break. When we come back, I'll talk to you a little more about Medicare supplement plans, about Medicare Advantage, and how to make, how do you navigate all this, right, and choose the right one for you. I'll help you with that when we come back. Join me here. We'll be right back on the Retirement Report. The time.